together, so I'm glad we're able to make it this morning. Let's go ahead and greet one another.
We can greet everybody.
Good morning.
Morning, Deb.
And then as the old custom was, sometimes I forget, we are Saint John.
Growing in Jesus and spreading his saving grace.
And we open then with hymn 394, Songs of Thankfulness and Praise, hymn 394.
Amen.
comes in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sins.
Almighty God, merciful Father.
I, a poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ.
Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in this stead, by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We continue with the entrance from Psalm 1. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous.
But the way of the wicked will perish.
Blessed is a man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked,
nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the harlots.
But his delight is in the law of the Lord.
And on his law, meditates day and
night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruits in its seasons, and its leaf does not wither.
In all that he does, he prospers.
Not so are the wicked are not so.
But the righteous have, and the wind cries away.
Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment,
nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, it is now, and will be forever. Amen.
For the Lord knows the way of the righteous,
but the way of the wicked will perish.
Lord, have mercy. know we live in the midst of so many dangers that in our frailty we cannot stand upright. Grant strength and protection to support us in all our dangers and carry us through all temptations. Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with the who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated for the lessons. The lessons are signed for today are for the fourth Sunday after the gift.
The Old Testament reading comes from Micah 6, 1-8. Hear what the Lord says. Arise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear you, mountains, the indictment of the Lord, and the enduring foundation of the earth, for the Lord has an indictment against his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Answer me, for I brought you up from the land of Egypt, and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember what Balak, king of the Moab, and what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Galgal, that you may know the saving act of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord, and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves of a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams and 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgressions, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson comes from 1 Corinthians 18-31. The word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the discernment of the discerning, and I will throw, where it is one who is wise, where is the scribe, where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since the wisdom of God and the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom. For we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and a folly to Gentiles. But to those who are called both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards, but not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose that was low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, whom God made our wisdom and our righteousness and our sanctification and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We then stand in honor of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and we sing the Alleluia. Blessed are the poor in spirit,
for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the word of the Lord. We then confess our faith is found in the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge us for the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. Is coming up.
Because we are so great in numbers today, we're all children of God. I hope you have enough treats for everybody, Pastor.
I do. Great. It's like the offering plate.
So my question today, and you're included, Myla, okay? My question for you today is, did you ever have a time where you were dealing with somebody, maybe in school or maybe at work, that they were a horrible troublemaker? And they did things that just weren't the way that we would want them to be. And I see Cynthia back there vehemently nodding her head. Yeah. So I got a story about that kind of a situation. There's a little boy by the name of Trent. And when Trent went to school, he caused all kinds of problems. He would pull on Peggy's pigtails. And at lunch, he would throw his food at the other kids in the cafeteria. Out in the playground, he would find one of his buddies. And he would trip him as they were running across the playground. All kinds of horrible things. How should we help Trent correct his behavior? Should we, don't get any ideas when I pull this out, should we maybe handcuff him to a chair? You think that's going to solve the problem?
No.
Cynthia, when you were vehemently shaking your head, do you think handcuffing one of your offenders, would that take care of the problem?
No.
Maybe we should take some rope and tie their hands and feet together so that they can't be tripping and they can't be pulling on pigtails and they can't be throwing their food. Is that going to solve the problem?
No.
I hope that you were listening to the words that Jane read to us from the prophet Micah. And I'm going to highlight some of those words. Micah was talking to us. God was talking through Micah to us in these Bible words. And basically what he's saying, listen up, people. You're doing this and you're doing that, and it's not making me happy. You're doing this wrong. These are the things that are not pleasing. And yet, at the very end of what she read, we hear these words. He has shown you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. So while we have all agreed that handcuffing somebody or tying them up with rope isn't going to solve the problem, how would we be able to solve that kind of a problem when we're dealing with bullies or people that don't do things the way God wants us to do? Maybe one thing that we can think of is to be that loving father and whisper in that person's ear the ways that God would want us to behave. Are you listening to this, Myla? Yeah? Show love and mercy to those who are doing things that make us sad, that hurt us. Those things that hurt us, those are called sins. And don't we do those every day? Sometimes we don't even realize when we're sinning. Sometimes we don't realize when we're singing, too. And yet God accepts that singing, and he accepts our repentance when we come to him and we say we're sorry. Let's demonstrate that to others. Show that forgiveness to them so that they know about the wonderful forgiveness that we've received through that gift that God gave us through Jesus. When Jesus came to the cross to die for our sins and come back to life so that we know one day we're going to be in heaven with him and singing his praises. Then our voices are going to be perfect. Pastor, would you close in prayer for us?
Are you talking to my mom? I wasn't really that bad.
No, I'm not that.
Okay. Let's pray. Gracious God.
Gracious God.
You have been merciful to us.
You have been merciful to us.
Now help us.
Now help us.
To love others.
For we know the great love
that Christ has for us. All this we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. We then continue with hymn 523, O God, Word of God Incarnate, hymn 523.
Thank you.
difficult to be a Christian in this world. It's just the reality that it's getting harder and harder to uphold the truths of God's Word. There's a hostility in our culture towards the Christian faith. Of course, Jesus says, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father except for me, and that's offensive. Many religious groups don't like that idea, and they condemn some of our basic Christian teachings. However, we understand that Jesus is the wisdom and understanding of God Himself in the flesh. We know that the wisdom and science and philosophy of this world cannot compare to Jesus Christ. We know what He did. He became weak and lowly. He became the foolish things of this world. He became sin itself on the cross and died for all sinners. And that message is a stumbling block to the world, because it's contrary to the wisdom of this age, which says, help yourself. You can do it. You have the power within you. But our wisdom and power come not from ourselves or from the world, but from God Himself, from Jesus Christ. Therefore, we are proud to be Christians, and we boast of what Jesus Christ has done for us. Now again, many people put their faith in science and technology, and certainly we do have a lot of good things that come from science and technology. It has made our lives better. Certainly we don't want to give that up. After all, we're Lutherans, not Amish. So we thank God for these blessings. We know it's important. And we do appreciate all the wonderful things we have in our country. But let me tell you that nothing in this world, no science, no technology, no philosophy, psychology, or other religion can make us better, can heal us inside spiritually. For that soul, created by God, given to us, is something under His care. And we're thankful we have that. St. Paul says in our lesson, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the one who is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? And again, yes, because science and technology cannot heal sin, cannot heal the soul, cannot bring us into that relationship with God. As good it is in this world, it has nothing to do with God and the life we have with Him now and forever. So the wisdom of this world can only go so far. Then it drops off. It's only God's wisdom who can bring life and life eternal. And so people want wisdom. That's what the Greeks loved. The Romans loved wisdom, philosophy. But there are others who wanted signs. Now the Jews demanded signs. Prove that you are the Son of God. I mean, this is just goes back into their history. We can think of people like Moses, right? He wanted a sign. "Are you sure I can do this, Lord?" "Fine, I'll give you a sign." Another person, Gideon, wanted a sign. He said, "Okay, well, why don't you make this fleece dry and the ground wet?" She did. Okay, well, how about making the fleece wet and the dry and the ground dry?" He did. But we must understand this was sinful. God did it, but that's not faith. Faith is something else. It would be nice if God could simply prove himself, come down from heaven. You know, really show us your glory. But remember, Jesus was tempted that way. Remember what he said? When the devil said, "Go ahead, throw yourself down. Prove to all of them you are the Son of God." "Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God." Why? Because signs don't bring us any closer to God. It is only faith in Jesus Christ that does that. And I know many people out there are looking for some kind of religious experience, some kind of emotional experience. And there are people who will take advantage of that. The world tries to get us to trust in our feelings and emotions. That's why we have such problems in the world. Is people are depending upon their own ideas and philosophies and feelings, and it comes from sin, because we are a sinful and fallen people. So we can't trust feelings and emotions, thoughts of the world. The only thing that we can truly trust is our faith in Jesus Christ. Because faith is not dependent upon our situation. It's not dependent upon how we feel. It's dependent upon God and the Son of God. And it's given by the gift of the Holy Spirit. And that's something that does not change. He's unchanging. This day and in every generation. So, God's wisdom comes from above. God's wisdom is seen in his humility. He humbled himself. God became a human being. God made manifest in Christ. They're a human being. And so he demonstrated God's love by being humble and gentle and kind, healing and lifting up those who were brokenhearted and those who were suffering. And this is what we base our faith on, not the ways of the world. You know, St. Paul reminds us, not many of you are rich, not many of you are wealthy or famous. In 100 years, nobody will remember us. There might be a marker out there in the cemetery, but nobody's going to go visit. That's reality. And we must be honest. As Paul says, if you're going to judge yourself by the way of the world, you will fail. Because remember, the world judges people by what they have and what they can do. All you have to do is look at sports. If you have talent and ability and you're able to throw a baseball in a little circle or a little imaginary square, rectangle, you get paid lots of money. Or you can throw a football accurately down the field. You paid lots of money. people value. Your names will be in Wikipedia. They'll be in the book somewhere. But most of us will not. Because most of us are average. It's kind of growing up, or raising our children. I always thought our kids are above average. And most people think their kids are above average. No, it's okay to be average. It's okay to be a little below average. I should know, I was a little below average in grades. That's okay. Because we don't judge ourselves by the way of the world. We judge ourselves by the cross and Christ crucified, who again took upon himself our sin, our unworthiness, suffered and died in our place for our life. And it may be that people find that offensive. That we believe Jesus is God in the flesh. We believe that we are, as we said, poor, miserable sinners. We believe that we need a Savior. We can't save ourselves. We believe that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. That through his life, death, and resurrection, brought this wisdom of God to us, this power from on high. And that's how we will see the world and ourselves, through the eyes of Christ. And so we boast about this. We're proud to be Christian. We're proud of Jesus. We don't have to make excuses for our faith. People may call us hateful, intolerant. But we're still proud of who we are in Christ. Not of who we are, per se, but who Jesus is. And he lives in us. We are proud that we have God's inspired and inerrant word. And we will judge all things, all spiritual things, according to that word. It's not just a book of morals. It's just not a history book. It's a book about life, salvation, Christ. And then Paul says, he is the source of your life. He's our source. So at times we'll be battered and bruised by this world. At times we will be beaten down. At times we will feel weak and powerless. Sometimes hopeless or in despair. But it is those times where God lifts us. He chooses those who are weak and he strengthens them. And he says, I will. I forgive you. I have life for you now and forever. And never forget that. That life in this world is passing, but life with Christ is eternal. Eternal. He's the wisdom. He's the power that brings that life to us today and now and forever. And again, we're proud to be Christians, proud to follow Christ, because in the end, when all of this comes to the end, it'll be Christ alone who is standing above all things. And we will be standing with him. That's our Lord and Savior. Now again, the world will be against Christ and his message and who he is and what he has done for us. But that's okay. That's okay. Because we have the wisdom and power of God in us. The wisdom of Christ. The lowly things, the
things that are not, the things the world would reject, is what Christ came to be. Through his life, death, and resurrection, we are forgiven and loved, and we have the power of God. What a wonderful thing that we have life with God now and forever, and we live in that vision, and we boast of that, and we're proud of that, because we know grace we will have now and forever. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. And we do give you thanks and praise for the offerings. And as we remember the gifts we have given, we sing the offertory, "Create in me a clean heart, O God."
Thanks and praise for the life you gave us at birth
We pray with Ashley Ruder, Keaton Simons, Samantha Rasmussen, Doris Buzzard, and Nancy Erickson as they celebrate their birthdays. Help us to remember the life you gave us at that moment we came forth from our mother's womb, and the life eternally gave us in our baptism, that we might enjoy life now and forever. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father, we also pray for the family and friends of Deidre Kara Hall. We know and feel that pain of separation and death. We cannot break that barrier. And we may feel alone. But give us faith to know that all who die in Christ have life now and forever, and that while we're separated, we are not separated forever. And help us then to live every day in that resurrection hope. Share that hope with others. Be a light in darkness. Be a light to those who mourn, and show a way of love and faith every day. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And finally, Father, we pray for the church. We pray that we will be faithful and strong in the face of all opposition, in the face of persecution, because we know when we face persecution, we are blessed. That as Christ faced opposition, so will we. But give the church your spirit and wisdom and understanding that we might be faithful to your word. Not backing down, not bending to the knee of culture, but remaining faithful and proclaiming that gospel, being proud of who we are, as Christians, as members of the Lutheran Church of Missouri City. And on that great day when Christ comes again, gather your church together, all of us, to be in that eternal kingdom that lasts forever. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray. Those we name here, those we name in our private prayers, trust in your mercy. Through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
And hear us, Father, as we pray together in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the prayer he taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. As we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you, gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace.
Amen.
Please be seated, and we close with hymn 869. With the Lord begin your task, hymn 869.
Thank you.
January day. But it is winter, and so we did finally get your snow. Those who love the snow, it'll be around a while. So we'll have real winter this week. But I'd rather have it in late January, early February, than in November. Because spring is coming, so we're looking forward to that. There'll be no adult Bible study today, and I don't know about confirmation. I see one student. Maybe we won't have confirmation today. We'll count it as a snow day. Because it is a snow day. Also coming up this week, quilting is tomorrow, and then next Sunday we'll have a BBS meeting, right? Who's going to do that? Ah, there she is. Sarah's a BBS leader. So right after church, we'll just have a, probably ask people to leave, and then we'll just get together and have a short meeting and discuss what's coming up. Because June is coming soon. Believe it or not, it's coming. And then I think Sylvie would like to talk about the blood drive.
Thank you. I want to thank everybody for helping with the blood drive. We have the final numbers. We collected 24 units of blood last Tuesday. And that means that we have helped 72 people, up to 72 people with those 24 donations. And that's a wonderful gift that we've shared, that God gives us, that we can share His love through our blood that He shed for us as well with others.
Thank you. We have any other announcements? Yes, yes.
Don't forget, today's the last day to sign up for the potluck.
Oh, yeah. Be sure to sign up for the potluck for Pastor Allen and Allison, right?
All man.
All man. I don't know why Allen. All man. All man. All man. What a name. He's all man. So now I'll remember. Go ahead and sign up today. What size you'd like to bring or dessert. Anything else? I didn't fix that.
It's named to order
the
meat. That's why.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
so
yeah.
No,
yeah, because we're going to order the meat, the main dishes, and so we need to know how many people, so we can get a pretty correct order for that. Anything else? Then go forth with the love of God. Christ is our wisdom and our power. We live with Him every day. We are proud to be Christian and proud to follow in His way of life now and forever. God bless and have a good day.